It's time for Get Your Act Together, The Showdown. On tonight's show, the owners, managers, and DJs of the Big L. And the man who gave them the Big E, impresario Harvey Goldsmith. Also on tonight's show, from Radio 1's Dream Team, DJ Spoony, Capital and Magic DJ, Neil Fox, and radio and TV legend, Ed Stewart.
Joining me in the Showdown Arena tonight are DJs, radio producers, technicians, and, of course, lots and lots of listeners. So let's welcome the stars of Big L. It's the heart and soul of rock and roll. So, guys, you've just watched the show for the first time. What's your first reactions?
Comedy show.
Comedy show.
It doesn't represent the truth at all. And I think the problem is that we have a radio station that we've built from the ground upwards, and are still building. We're going out and selling that to people. What we really wanted Harvey to help us with was marketing the station. And I think there's a lot that's been cut out of the programme, but I think we all felt that this has been a missed opportunity.
Well, I think we should have a look at the Big L guys watching the show.
Me? I'd fire the whole bloody lot of them and program it from home.
I don't understand if anybody in that station has a clue about how to get an audience. One would assume that Mike and David would understand that.
You can always find somebody to do this fucking job yourself.
That's all right, Gary. Don't get upset, mate.
There's the controls. Don't worry. Get on with it.
I'm going to stick it up Chris Veazey's backside to prove to him, which is what I said I would do when I went up there, that we can make the changes, so why the hell can't he?
I know what I'm doing. It may not be in line with what Harvey really has in mind for the radio station, but then I know the radio business better than he does.
You two could have owned these five cars twice. That's how much money I believe you've thrown away. What have you got now? A clapped-out station that's going absolutely nowhere. I'm done.
Thank you, Harvey. That's great. Well, that's great.
So your relationship with Harvey was pretty tense from the start. Do you think you gave him a fair crack of the whip?
We actually listened to everything Harvey said. It is very interesting to get other people's point of views on what you're doing. And if you close your mind to everything that anyone says to you, you're stupid. But if you've worked in the business as long as the team that we have there, then you've got pretty good ideas of where you want to go anyway.
Well, I think it's time we met the man who caused all the trouble. It's Harvey Goldsmith. Right, well, welcome again, Harvey. I mean, clearly, you had a lot of work to do when you first got to the Big L. I mean, what were the main problems for you?
I think the key issue was that no commercial station can run without income unless you've got philanthropists behind it. And my concern was, how long could these guys keep funding this station? And as I said to them the first time I ever met them, they're either on some really clever tax wheeze, in which case could they please share it with me, or they're being led down the garden path because they're hemorrhaging money.
Do you see yourselves breaking even in the near future?
Well, we either do or we...
Because at the moment, the Big L stands for the big loss, doesn't it? You're losing £50,000 a month.
But if you have any business startup, you don't expect to make money to start with. I think we're not experts in radio, but the thing that everybody keeps saying to me is you make a product, you build an audience, and then you sell to them. And that's what we're doing.
Ian, I'm from a speech station in London.
Nick LBC. Ferrari, I know you are, LBC.
That's who I am, right. There's a nautical theme running through all of this, Ian.
There is.
And I just wonder whether the people who run the Big L were actually taking care of 15 sailors and marines in the Al Shat waterways by Iran the other day, because I have never seen such incompetence in all my life. Every product I've ever worked on, LBC, The Sun, News of the World, Fox Television, Sky News, has known its audience. You could go out and you could bloody well see your reader or your viewer in the street. To turn down Harvey's ideas, they are actually guilty, I'll tell you what, of criminal bloody arrogance.
Right. Because well, I don't want to be rude.
He has more marketing ability, and I don't know, I mean, Christ knows how these guys make their money, yeah. And good luck to them, but it's utterly shambolic.
OK, so, well, Chris, you know, you've been working at it for quite a while now. Yeah. What is your strategy?
Most stations you listen to are playing 180 songs rotated round and round and round. We've got a rotation of about 600 songs now that is a core song base. So therefore, already, you have got a fantastic sound of classic rock tracks over the years.
Surely, if you're going to tune into a radio station every day, you want to hear different music.
Exactly. It's the records, but those records only contribute half of the music in every hour. So you have a core basic sound to the radio station with the extras put in between. But you still have got maintained a good station sound that you know you're going to hear those good records. Throughout
you don't know when they're going to be on, though, do you?
They're scheduled.
Is that the marketing strategy?
No.
Tune in, you might hear one of your favourite songs.
No.
I think it matters at all if you have 8 million records, if you're not playing the records your audience wants. So people criticise modern radio stations for having a small playlist. It doesn't matter as long as they're the ones that your audience wants to listen to.
Who tells you what records to play, though, Neil?
We've got a programme director, and that's absolutely fine. I think the problem with looking at that was you had some old boys who used to be in the glory days of the 60s, which was a massively different time. You were groundbreaking. You're playing the pop music for kids of the time. They could suddenly tune into pop music for the first time ever, and they were loving it all. Now, 40 years on, we've got a completely different radio business.
How do you get your enjoyment, though, if you're like a robot just playing the records you've been told
to play? Not at all. I like the music I'm playing. I work for a station, Magic, that I really like. We play incredibly diverse music, but we know who our audience is, and we're trying to target our audience. These guys on Radio 1 know their audience. They're targeting their audience.
Spoonie?
I think it goes beyond just the music. I think Neil touched on it there. It's about the audience. I came into broadcasting through music and a love of music, and just that alone is not enough, because otherwise might as well get my friends around my front room and just
play
to them.
Is that what you thought the Big L was like?
Yeah, because I think it's taking it to the next level now. The brand and the product is the music. Where is the audience? Yeah. Now, where do we get the audience? The first thing that I would do if I was in charge of that station was try and visualise it. So everybody in Frinton and surrounding areas knew who we were and knew where we were. I would move the studio out of that building, all right? And I'd let everyone be able to see them passing, whether they're in a Perspex studio in a shopping centre or just somewhere where people can see them physically all the time. If you made that studio modern, if you made them see young people walking about in front of them as well as old people, then they might be a little bit more in tune to who is listening.
We felt when we were watching it, we were sitting next to each other, they were trying to recreate like a boat feel. Mm. You live in a house together, you got these, I mean, have these people not got families or lives all living in a little house together?
I just don't want to listen to a load of old blokes who I hold in enormous esteem, and they were groundbreakers in their day, but they're plonking about in a house in front of it, and I couldn't give a bugger whether they eat chili con carne all night and fart in the morning. I couldn't care less. And I certainly don't want to listen to them in the morning.
Fair enough.
We talked a while ago, and only just now you've admitted that now the station's got focus. And yet all the way through the film, we're hearing about all these heritage presenters, all this wonderful management experience, and now we've suddenly decided we need focus. I think that's incredible. I don't expect the shareholders to know that. You rightly say, I'm not a radio person. But you've employed some of the most familiar radio experience you can get, and now you've decided the station needs focus.
Heart FM's quite a successful station, I believe.
We have our moments.
Yeah, there you go. That's from someone... someone who's been in the business for years and knows what he's talking about. How would you respond to that?
Well, I suppose with the focus, you're right. I mean, that was the one thing, I suppose, really, and I mean, we sat down with the expert panel, they were called at the time. That was useful, and what came out of it for us, really.
Yeah. But it took the expert panel to give you focus, and you're spending all this money on the expert talent and the management.
The fact
that
we were already
focus.
Moving there, the problem was that we were moving all our... We kicked all the computers out, we bought all new gear in. I had to make a decision what I worked on first. I left the music until I got all the new gear in, because I didn't want to do it twice.
So you went for your equipment before you decided what to do on the radio?
No. I kicked out all the music after, you know.
Right, OK.
I chose to leave
Scott
it
Scott Solder from LBC.
Yeah.
I'm just confused that focus was the F word. It came in much later than seemed sensible. You're worrying about what computers you got in what room.
No,
you
no,
were
no.
moving towards focus in time, were you? Is that what you're saying?
We were at the time when we actually met the guys who the Focus guys,
right?
Gillian Reynolds and people and the advertising agency and guy from EMAP.
Yeah.
We were just changing our stuff over the week we had the meeting.
But why did it take a meeting of four radio professionals to tell you?
We were doing it before we had the meeting.
How long had you been the programme director before you decided that you should focus the station?
I knew I was going to focus the station.
What, before you started?
Not before I started, no, when I got into the job.
So how long did it take you to
decide? 3 months.
3 months to decide on the focus of your radio station?
To turn it.
Honestly.
Okay, Harvey, you've been vindicated to a certain extent.
Look.
How do you feel now, when you've heard that?
I personally feel upset. When I was given the opportunity to kind of work with this office, with the radio station, I wanted this to be an... I got so excited about it, I was more interested in this programme than all the others, because I really felt this was a fantastic opportunity. And what I just can't understand, and it's been said time and time again, is the arrogance of these people who basically are sitting there pissing away money every bloody week, haven't got a clue what they're doing, and are worried about computers, and raise out in Holland trying to buy a £3 million boat when he's talking about a 500... What?
More and more people are listening to the radio than ever before, and we sent James out, and he found out what the prospects are for radio stations like the Big L.
The breakfast show is the most popular of the day, so radio stations compete fiercely to win listeners over and hopefully keep them for the rest of the day. Now, Terry Wogan's breakfast show currently tops the ratings with almost 8 million listeners tuning in every morning. The digital era has created a new golden age of radio, with a number of listeners in Britain reaching a record high of more than 45 million every week. There are already over 350 national and local UK radio stations available online, and more appearing all the time. With the number of people tuning into the radio via the internet rising by 10% last year, having a great website is crucial nowadays for any radio station to succeed. But the web isn't the only way to listen. An audio channel on Sky Digital gives a radio station access to a potential of 7 million households. And with more and more people tuning in via mobile phones and listening to podcasts, radio really is available anytime, any place, anywhere. But there's no point having a fantastic show if people don't know it's out there. Have you ever heard of a radio station called Big L?
No.
No.
Big L? Mm. One of my favourites.
Never.
No, never heard of it.
No.
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 You need great branding and effective publicity to target a well-defined audience. In a marketplace as wide and varied as radio today, you need to be really distinctive to stand out.
So, James, is it a good time to be starting a radio station now?
I think it's a very tough time to be starting radio because there is so much competition. And you're not just competing against the traditional BBC radio stations. You've got a raft of commercial radio stations. You've also got to deal with AM, FM, the digital licensing. You've also got DAB and you've got the internet. And the fact is that because you have a lack of focus, when you come to sell yourselves, not only to your audience to build that, but to advertisers, they don't know what you're selling.
OK, cheers, James. Well, if it was up to me, I'd just let Gary Williams broadcast 24 hours a day. And to prove that Gary's not forgotten anything since he was trained by Ray and Harvey, we thought we'd let him show off his silky skills on the TV airwaves. Gary, come on over here, mate. It's all yours.
Well, coming up next, we'll find out if Neil Fox is worried about competition from the Big L. We'll also be asking DJ Spoony how he got his act together. We'll also be reliving the glory days of pirate radio with Ed Stewart. But right now, here's Queen and their classic hit, Radio Gaga.
Welcome back to Get Your Act Together, The Showdown. Earlier tonight on Channel 4, we saw exactly what happened when Harvey Goldsmith tried to help the Big L, a one-time pirate radio station relaunched in 2005 by Ray Anderson. The L stands for London, but in reality, the station is based in Frinton-on-Sea.
Well, welcome to our humble home, if you would care to step this way, sir.
Across here, across the board, across the corridor, is Raimondo's bedroom, and he is our head of operations. Here we have the guest loo, if you care to step this way, sir.
At least five or six presenters have sat on this loo, but not at the same time.
No. Well, this is my little bedroom. I opened up the wardrobe and I thought, this is tremendous. I can keep all my clothes here. I don't have to take them home every week. But then all of a sudden I realised that the other side was another pair of doors, and through the doors came Mike Reed!
My jacket!
Nicking my clothes!
Ray, if I can ask you first, is that not a bit strange? Five grown men living in a house together, doing all their washing and cleaning and cooking
together? It's actually good fun, and we work hard, we play hard. You know, it's a house where we all live. Because everybody lives, you know, 70, 80 miles away from where the radio studios are,
yeah,
it's a great way of just all being together. And what we tend to do, we get up in the morning, we have breakfast, we sometimes, Chris and I, we'll work 18-hour days, and then we'll come back, cook dinner, and we'll still be talking. We were up to 1:20 this morning, still talking business.
And the other good thing about having people like that, that talent working around a dinner table, is the amount of business that gets done around that table.
What idea has it come up with that's worked? What idea has it come up with that has worked?
I can tell you something. If one thing that came round out of that dinner table, Mike came down and sat down and said he was going to walk from Edinburgh to Frinton. He has now, if you watch television, not pissed at all.
Knowing that the Proclaimers were in the chart with the Comic Relief single, Mike, very kindly, decided to hair on up to Edinburgh, and he's walking and cycling 500 miles. And we've had three film crews, I think local ITV film crews, out there. And it's really to promote the station.
Walking on the radio isn't the best entertainment you can get, you know? There's a lot of people walk to work. I walk every day. So I'll read that in the paper. I'll tune in. How are you getting on, Mike? I'm still walking. Brilliant. Cheers. Is that entertainment? That's not going to hold me in there, you know? It's really not.
All right, Welshie, what sort of stunt would you organise?
I don't know. Say to Mike, last say 10 miles, do it naked, we'll double the money. Tattoo him as well. You know, you get a local tattoo artist, tattoo his backside, everything. Just hype it up a bit, go a bit further. Walking is not going to do it, honestly. Now, Harvey had a very good promotion there about, you know, Mile High Club. Yeah. Why was that put to the side? That seemed quite good.
We didn't put it to the side.
But you didn't promote it either.
We promoted it. The whole point of the competition, Harvey, you said, I'm going to get some traction for this radio station. I've got this idea of join the Mile High Club.
It's one way to get traction.
I'm going to get you press on this, and the press is going to get people to tune into your radio station to hear it.
But you've got to promote it first.
No, we don't.
And you did have press.
You said that
you had the Sun, you had the Express, you had the Star, you had Sky News, you had Reuters and AP.
No.
That's not bad for a start.
No, you sent the press release to them.
Spoonie, let's say Spoonie.
The thing on that is, and whether or not that was a good idea or not, whether 40 to 60 year olds want to be kind of doing that, I hope I will do when that time comes round for me.
Don't worry, mate.
Well, whether it's a good idea or not, what I would have expected to have seen is that if they turn around and said, Harvey, that idea's a load of rubbish, but what about these ideas? What about this idea? What about that? So I wouldn't have minded them saying, your idea's bad, but then you've got to come with an alternative. And I haven't seen any, and I didn't see any.
We didn't like the idea that Harvey came up with because we thought it was a little bit sleazy.
Why did you go with it?
Sleazy sex sells.
While you've got national TV filming, you've got one of the greatest concert promoters with Live 8, weren't too bad. It might be just worth going with it, because what seems to be is...
But
going it in a proper way, because seems to be a lot of arrogance going on that behind the scenes, he'd say, do this, and then he'd go, oh, I think we know better, wanker.
What really galled me was the whole thing about this website. They only... After I spoke to Adam when I was at the Albert Hall, and I called him up and said, this is just bloody ridiculous, this competition, you can't find the competition. But Adam got on the case, and lo and behold, the day the competition was due to close, they changed the website so this thing was on the front page. The website was just crap. You can change it overnight. What the hell was Chris doing for 5 months?
Chris?
Not looking at that, not thinking about the format, and worrying about boats and changing his computers.
No, I didn't. Wasn't worried about boats at all, Harvey.
Well, then why the hell weren't you there when Ray came to see you?
Harvey.
You were looking at boats.
If you do a competition like that, Right, if you buy your Sun newspaper tomorrow and they're giving you a chance to win a flight, or you buy your News of the World and they're giving you a chance to have a hamburger for threepence, it is all over the front page. So if you're going to do something, you have to believe in it. What you can't have is people hunting for it on the internet. DJs, these guys can talk about it. If they're doing a great competition on Heart, if they're doing a great competition on any of the other stations on LBC, you've got to go for it. Pardon my language, Ian, balls and all.
OK, you we've got someone from Heart sitting next to you, Mark Browning. You're the programme director at Heart?
Yeah, and there's just
Would you do something like that?
Stunts, absolutely. Gets people talking about your radio
station. Would you do that one, though? Do you think it's too sleazy?
No, that fits their target audience. If they're aiming for blokes over 40, then there's something to talk about. It's totally targeted. It's not my favourite idea of all time, but it's not my radio station.
May I ask this question? Everybody on this call, all my broadcasting colleagues, have you all listened to Big L before you came on this?
No.
You see? And how can you mouth off like that?
I don't need to. Because I've watched the programme, I've listened to these people.
Yes, of course I can.
I happen to know I don't like Finder's Fresh Fingers. I don't need to eat them.
Excuse me, you don't watch a TV programme like that and then say, I know the product.
There's been nothing that's... In fact, I am their dream punter. I'm the person they could convert. I've sat down, I've endured, because that's the word, not watched, I've endured an hour of something that's like The Producers meets Benny Hill. I've listened endlessly to the man over there, two very well-meaning people who I think have been duped out of buckets of cash. I've watched a bloke who I admire enormously in the
Live Aid. I think duped's a very strong word there, Nick, to be fair.
All right, maybe conned. I've listened to a bloke there who put Live Aid together and I respect him. I don't need to listen and I'm certainly not going to find the Big L, but I wish you the best of luck. I respect your tradition.
Ed Stewart, do you want to respond to that?
Well, no, you can't criticise a product without knowing what that product either sounds like or looks like, and I think that you're very naughty.
Chris, do you think that Harvey's involvement has been a good thing or not?
I think Harvey's involvement has been very interesting. It has actually galvanised us as a team very much because some of the things that Harvey has suggested we haven't necessarily agreed with. We wouldn't have done this walk all the way down the country, which anyone in this audience thinks has actually brought us in one hell of a lot of publicity right through our transmission area. We wouldn't have done that had we not felt that the bed in the sky caper didn't work. So there's been a lot that's come out of it.
It was an interesting experience. In some ways, the programme that we've seen, it wasn't really representative of what's happening, and I don't think we've had a particularly fair crack of the whip, but, hey, it's television.
And, Harvey, was it your biggest challenge of the series so far?
Definitely. And, as I said, I'm upset that I didn't help them make this a success.
Would you invest money in the Big L now?
I'd invest in that concept. I'd just put the money in. But I can't, because the group that are running this station don't have a focused idea on where they're going, what they're trying to play, and who their audience is. If they had that, then I would spend 24 hours a day with them.
Ian and Adam, do you regret putting all your money into the Big L and just seeing it disappear like that?
We haven't quite put all of it in.
Well, you keep saying that. You're not telling us where you're getting money from, though. But you've lost a lot of money. Do you regret that?
Well, we've only lost it if at the end of the day it folds and nothing happens and we don't sell the station, so you can't say we've lost it, because that isn't actually true.
Fair point.
Do you regret letting this man through your doors in the first place?
Never.
Well, we should have a big round of applause for everyone from the Big L and, of course, to Harvey Goldsmith. I'm Ian Hyland, and you've been watching Get Your Act Together, The Showdown. Thanks for watching, and see you next week.